Yeah, it's the tallest man in Vienna sitting here. So. You're 2 meters or so?
2'10".
2'10"?
Yes.
Wow!
It's big!
Built by oak tree.
Yeah. But that's oak. Very good. That's oak.
Mm-hmm. Coconut picker you can become.
Yeah, coconut. Maybe.
2'10", wow. We had in a movie we made about non-duality, there was this scientist, he's 2 meters and 4 centimeters. And even that was already.
I met that guy who was 2'15 in Berlin and he came to me and said, "Hello, Klein. Hello, small guy."
But you always have to bow when, not in this house, but in a lot of houses, yeah.
In the new houses, yes.
But you probably are so used to it, you don't even think about it anymore.
Yeah.
He had more than 10,000 hours to...
Yeah, absolutely.
To exercise.
It all goes automatically.
Actually, I calculated, this is more than 1 year, 10,000 hours.
To if you,
it's a little bit, it's like 40, about 40 weeks.
Yeah, if you practice every day 3 hours, seven days a week, and then 10 years.
10 years, yeah.
But they did research like very talented violin players at a young age. One of them became a very famous violin player throughout the whole world, and the other one just became a teacher, a violin teacher. And that was because this guy practiced more than 10,000 hours and the other one just 4,000. So in order to become really good at something, you have to have the talent, just genetics. If it's not there, it doesn't work. And then it's just a lot of training.
Doing,
yeah. Training. And then the synapses, the connection between brain cells, they will get so strong and so fast, these connections, that you really operate at the highest level. So it's like Lionel Messi, the famous soccer player.
Yeah.
He is also, he was just built genetically in a great way, and then he just trained and trained. But whether you do that or not, it's just not in your hands. It's just, he's also programmed to want to play football. And what I like about him is that Ronaldo has got like, his ego doesn't even fit in this room. But with Messi, he's so humble.
Mm-hmm.
And when they interview him, he's just like, "Yeah, I just like playing soccer.
Yeah.
And I still like playing soccer." That's it.
Just the usual guy.
Yes. Yeah.
Around the corner.
And when Ronaldo scores, you're always like, points at him. And when Messi scores, it's like, he gives it to a ball. It's so cute. Yeah. Must be really
2 hours styling for Ronaldo.
Yeah. So funny. But even with the big ego, you can play soccer very well. So.
what did you want to express actually by this 10,000 hours? It needs 10,000 hours that you can play guitar like the man you were showing yesterday. Why do you put it in the whole slideshow?
Oh,
what's the essence of that?
It's just what I try to...
Come from conscious to unconscious?
No, it's just everything we actually do is unconscious. Our awareness is just a tiny little bit of what you're doing. But in order for this unconscious machine to be operating at the highest level, it needs training. So if we think that we are the one... like in companies, they say we have to change, as if we control the change. We don't. This apparatus is changing all the time. Whatever you practice, it will get better at. Whatever you do not use, what you don't use, you lose, they say. So we, as human beings, are continuously changing automatically. And after that, the illusion is being created that we are the one doing the change. And that's the illusion. But then also when, like when Messi is playing his game, he doesn't think while playing. He's just going automatically moving around. At the moment he would start thinking about, oh, what shall I do with the ball? Shall I play to this guy? Then you're too late. It's impossible to think. And then a while ago people asked me, so if you don't think that much, so if you would play soccer you would be very good. I'm like, well, first of all, it's not in my genetics to be a good soccer player, and I didn't train 10,000 hours, but everything else I might be very okay. So it's just a and also when you play tennis, the ball is going so fast that at a conscious level, it's impossible to return the ball. So it's just a reflex continuously. It's like clang, clang. So all these famous tennis players, they have been training all over and all over again. And then they became very good.
So it's the one, the man winning who is not more conscious, but who is more unconscious.
In of a way, two, yes. Well, people. Of course. Yeah, when you're playing soccer, you are aware of the ball or the goal or whatever, but that's very small, our awareness. Also, what the eye sees is, we saw that yesterday, when you spread your arm, it's the top of your thumb. I'm looking at you and I'm looking at one of your eyes and everything else is blurry. So that's why at school I was so good in cheating while looking at another guy what he was doing, because the teacher has to scan the whole classroom in order to pick you, like, hey, you're cheating. But the teacher of course thinks he has total control, which is bad. Mm-hmm. It's funny how our awareness creates a lot of illusions about ourselves. And of course we think we are very aware of things, because you're not aware of what you're not aware of. Mm. I mean, you don't know what you don't know, and therefore it looks like you know a lot. But actually, we know shit, nothing. Okay. Yeah.
That's funny.
Yeah. Because, like, when you're beginning of your 20s, let's say, sometimes I meet people that age. They really think they know a lot. They know a lot about life. But then when you turn 30, you're like, wow, I was so unaware when I was 20. And then you're 40, you're like, I was so stupid when I was 30. And at the end of your life, you're still like, I've been an idiot my whole life. So yeah, what do we know? And even science, I mean, a scientist, what does he do? He tries to understand things with his 60 bits of consciousness. So even science is not true. Even Einstein, the genius, I mean, he came up with theories and 5 or 10 years later he was like, oh no, I was wrong. Next theory. And that's been going on for decades. New theories come up. And everything that Newton thought of about the universe seemed to be, or most of it seemed to be wrong in the end. So we can't even rely on science. So also with this whole non-dual message, you don't need to know anything. And what I like about the concept of non-duality, or the, as they call it, advaita, it simply means not two. Non and I is not, and duality or advaita is two. So what it says, everything is not two. Which is very clever, I think, because if you say everything is one, then you make a truth out of it. You say, it's one, that's the truth. But they say, no, we have got absolutely no idea what it is, but it is not two. That's smart, huh? The negative approach, yeah.
Perhaps it's three?
No, no, no. You don't get it. It's not two, that's what they say. But they just point out that this whole seemingly dual world is it's a dream. It's a nice dream. I mean, without yin and yang, there would be no experience. I did an interview with Dana, and we also said, if this whole room would be green, we would never know what green is. You can only know green if there's an opposite or a different color. So if you constantly try to be happy, you will fail, because we don't know. You can only know happiness by being unhappy. And why we try to seek for this happiness continuously is because the trick of the brain is that it's getting used to everything. I use a metaphor a lot, that when you step into a hot tub, what gives you the thrill, the nice feeling, it's the raise of temperature in the first 30 seconds. You get in and you're like, oh, wow. It's the change that gives you this. But then when you're in the hot tub for 10 minutes, you're like, what shall I do? And then you get back into the cold water, you're like, oh, cold water. But then you're in the cold water for a few minutes, like, oh, nothing wrong, you can swim. So, but this goes for everything. No matter how much money you've got, how big your house is, how big your sports car, the brain gets used to it. You buy a new car and it's the change in luxury for the first few days that gives you the thrill, and then you're back to normal again. So we try to, the way we often live, we're in the hot tub and we try to add more hot water, hotter, 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 until we burn ourselves. And there are a lot of people with a lot of money being very depressed. Because... So, the body-mind mechanism will always try to prefer pleasure above pain. That's the natural function of the body, which is useful, because if you have pain, for instance, in your stomach or at your arm, it will automatically try to solve the pain. But when we think we are in control in our life of when there will be pain or pleasure, that's when the struggle begins. Because at the moment there's pleasure, we enjoy the pleasure for a while, like having a new relationship. It's like, oh, this is pleasure. And at the same time, this fear comes up. It's like, what if I lose this? And then the pleasure, it's gone, because there is fear instantly. And when we try to get rid of the pain, then the whole struggle begins. Why does it happen to me? How long will this last? I should have done it differently. So in our mind, we struggle a lot with this pleasure and pain stuff. But for instance, a dog who doesn't think about all this stuff, the dog will also try to gain pleasure. It will try to eat the sausages. That's pleasure. And it will try to avoid pain. It will not attack a bigger dog because it might lose. So that's the natural function of the body. But without the thoughts we project on those experiences, that's just what it is. So, pain may arise, that pain is just part of life, but suffering is additional. Suffering is pain plus a thought. And that's the difference.
So the pain is still there, even if we don't think about it? Because yesterday you said that you can fall back into your contraction. Oh, I feel so bad about this and that. And then you have a phone call and it's gone?
Yeah.
Yes, but the suffering is gone. The pain is not gone.
The pain can go. Even if you have like a pain at your teeth, you're like, oh! And then suddenly you're hammering, you're at your thumb, it's then the focus is on this and not here. No, it's not in your awareness, so it's here. So even physical pain is even bigger when the focus is on there. But when there's really a terrible pain, I'm sure the focus will be, if you break your leg, then the focus will be a lot at the leg. Yeah.
But that's a solution. Create always more pain if you have pain somewhere.
Yeah. But yeah. And there's even, how do you call this? The disease of that you are already afraid of getting the pain. And then you already suffer from that. Yeah.
Yes, but you need not take another pain. It's just the change of focus that can distract or help or change something.
Yeah, because for instance,
if I have a problem, I can go for a walk. I can try to solve the problem here and now in sitting, and I will not. But I can just say no. I go for this or that, something else.
Yeah.
Just to do a change.
The funny thing is that a problem. There are no problems because life is always as this. But if in our brain there's like, okay, for instance, you get fired from work. The thought may arise, this is a problem because I need to pay my rent, blah, blah, blah.
Okay.
Then when you try to solve that problem in thoughts, what happens is, yesterday we used the metaphor of this quiet lake, and every thought is a stone in the lake, and it does. So I'm fired is like one thought. But once you start trying to solve the problem, which is already a thought, with thoughts, then you get more stones and more, and suddenly the whole lake is like, wow, chaos here. So, and the funny thing is when you start doing a different activity, then your awareness is like walking in the forest at the moment. And at the moment that the thoughts about being fired do not come up, there's no problem and there's no suffering anymore. So for, even if you've got a huge problem, then for many hours of the day, you don't even think about it. The problem does not exist. Only at those moments that it comes into your small awareness, and it's like, oh yeah. Especially, that's what I find fascinating about waking up. When you wake up, then this hard drive doesn't start instantly. It's like rolling. So for a few seconds, it's like bliss. And then it's like, ah, shit, I got fired. And then it spins again. So it's funny how the brain works. So trying to get rid of thoughts with thoughts is like trying to wipe away blood with blood. it's a mess. But then again, if it happens, because you're not in control of your thoughts, then it just happens. But it's such a realization when you've believed your whole life that I am a separate entity and I am in control of what this thing acts like, what it chooses, what it feels, or what it thinks. This belief in this separation creates so much struggle. When I look back, I can only look back in story length, of course, but man, there was a lot of suffering, because if things didn't go as I wanted to go, oh man, there was a huge struggle, there was frustration, there was anger. I was like, I should have made it! And I would start to blame other people, and suddenly I didn't like the world. Like, I hate it! And then, when there was the realization that this thing, this piece of energy is just at play. It's right now it's talking, and sometimes it's sleeping, and this morning it was drinking coffee, and but it can't do anything else than what's happening. There's no one in here doing anything. There's no one in this room. That's amazing, because then life is just as it is. So there's nothing to worry about anymore. So life is simple, not easy. And it's simple because it is as it is, and it's not easy because this amazing life has the gift, actually, of giving you these circumstances where you're being triggered, like So life is just throwing you like, and there you go. But at the moment, as you just, okay, now I go, then it's just not that big deal anymore. And it's not someone's fault, it's not your fault, you couldn't have done it different or whatever. So then it becomes more relaxed. You're not panicking anymore. But it's not something that you can do, it's something that may happen. Because it's also, I've had many friends who were trying to act enlightened, this enlightened behavior. And what they did, if something happened, they would say, no, I'm okay with it. This doesn't touch me at all. No, I don't blame you at all, it's okay. And then something again happened. No, not a problem, because there's not even someone in here who could be bothered. It's okay. And that happened like 10 times, and the 11th time it's like, they explode, and all this anger from those previous 10 times come out at once, and it's like, I do die. So the body-mind mechanism can fool itself for a while, but... And also all these teachers who like pretend to be so-called enlightened, they're all full of shit. It's like, this is life, everything is just happening. It's this spiritual mode as if there's something more special. But talking about non-duality is not better or worse than ordering pizza. It's both life at play. It's nothing special about it. But especially when the ego hasn't been played out in life, like exploring itself, becoming important, trying to get the status. When you've done all this, that circus, and you finally realize, oh, it's not it, then okay, it drops. But what sometimes happens, when someone didn't have the chance in his regular life to play the ego out, like in every way, and it becomes a spiritual teacher, then for the first time the ego gets like the opportunity to be someone. Like, but I'm a teacher, and my teaching is better than their teaching. And then there becomes this whole circus around the guru. And especially when other people try to convince you that you are special, man, there's nothing better for the ego than sitting in front of a group of people pretending to know everything. And they will come up with questions and you have the answers. This is the most pleasurable way to be sitting here. There's nothing better than this. And the seeker, who feels insecure and has a lot of pain, will do anything to get out of that pain. So anything you say, they will buy it. Mm. I was in America, I saw teachers, they were full of shit, and but everyone's, yeah. They would be like, if you want to be enlightened like this, if you want to be enlightened, then 12 times a day, breathing, and for 5 seconds, and I guarantee you, if you do this for 3 months, you'll be enlightened. Just like that. And we were like, what the fuck? Liar. And then at the end of the day, we got him drunk. And when he was drunk, he was like, well, look, this is my $1 million house. I bought it, and this is my Tesla car. It's 130,000 euros. And it was totally like, wow. But they can get away with it, because the seeker will always try to find hope. And as long as you give people hope. And therefore this message is terrible for the seeker. Because the seeker, the best thing that you can give the seeker is tell you, okay, if you want to be enlightened, there are 7 steps. First, eat vegetarian food. Yeah. Then meditate on my words. If you give them a method, they will try to do it and they will think they'll get there. But the terrible message is, you're not the doer. And this is why this is such a tough philosophy. Because we've been conditioned our whole life that if you want to be good at something, like the 10,000 hour rule, yeah, if you want to be a good soccer player or a good artist, you practice for 10,000 hours and then you're a pro. So it's so logical that when we hear about enlightenment, we think, okay, now I'm in a struggle and I have to become enlightened. So I have to practice and practice to get it. But then you come to a non-dual meeting and at this point it says, no, it's already there. Sorry, no, this can't be. I'm in a struggle. Tell me what to do. And like, you're not a doer. And it's constant. I want to get there. Tell me. And this is horrible for the seeker. Until it realizes that it was already there. Because it doesn't matter whether there is tension or whether it's relaxation. It's both happening in this, yeah. Just give it a name. So liberation has more to do with just an insight rather than to do something. And of course with meditation you can train the brain to become more relaxed. But even then, as long as the individual thinks I am meditating to get from A to B, there is still the illusion of being separate, not being good enough and having to accomplish something. So Maharishi Mahesh Yogi said, you can meditate for 1,000 years and still miss the point. Because then you've got these people with a huge meditation ego. I've got letters from people who are totally angry with me. So I've been meditating for 12 years and you're saying... And like, yeah, because they are so attached to their practice of meditation and I'm just taking away their status. It's like flat. But in the end, with this whole awakening, you become more and more humble. You realize you know nothing. There's nothing special about you. There's just life happening. But this is dying while you're still alive. But who wants that? Ramesh used to say, if you could choose between $1 million and enlightenment, pick $1 million.
But as you said, you can train a lot of things with practice, and you could also train non-duality talks, so to say. So if you attend thousands of meetings non-duality, and I guess there are a bunch of people talking about that which have heard about it and just make a copy of it, what they've heard about it. Would you recognize the difference between somebody who is just talking in theory about it, or let's say if you had a kind of awakening or whatever you want to call it? I mean, the word
I think
same.
So, because when I'm with people who are not that strongly identified anymore, the energy is different. There's just and this is just in Storyland what I'm going to say now, but I can feel some kind of relaxation with these people, and I can open my heart. I've experienced with you now. I was totally opening my heart, and I've known you for a day, because there's nothing that holds me back from expressing things as it is. Mm-hmm. But surrounded by people with identification and strategies and want to get something out of you, then the system will not resonate in that way. So I would say yes.
On an energetic level, more than on an intellectual level.
Just feelings, it has nothing to do with the words, it's just the resonance between people. Mm-hmm. And I've seen also people in Holland, they thought, oh, I'm going to be a non-duality teacher. But once you're going to sit here, the audience will kill you. Because if there's something not pure from what you're saying, they will automatically get... So I've seen people die on stage. Also, there was a student of Isaac Shapiro. He was also, I'm going to be a guru now. Man, it was a cool guy. He went with his head like this off. So, but yeah, you can, it happens that when the ego is still wanting to be someone that yeah, also in the whole spiritual world, these people think of it, I'm a Reiki master, or I'm at this level, or there's a lot of spiritual ego going on, and there's also a lot of non-duality ego going on.
I guess so.
Yeah. And that's also when one teacher, and there's a lot of gossip in this scene, like, my teaching is better than their teaching, and they're too soft, or they're too radical. But what's been overlooked, that all these puppets talking about it are all full of bullshit, because no one can, we can only point at it, that's it. And then I think it's beautiful that everyone's pointing in his or her own way. So, and at the moment we think that that's a good way, that's the bad way, then we're already in separation again, and in good and bad and concepts. So in the end, it all doesn't matter.
I even experienced Tony Parsons falling into this trap of criticizing other teachers very emotionally. I just experienced it when he said, oh, there are so many other teachers, like wow. It just happened.
Yeah.
And then I tried to feel what was this now? Was he losing his it was interesting for me, because usually he's not doing it. It was not this energy around him or in the room, but it happened. So, but I don't think he was using this consciously to show something or so.
Yeah, but also talking is just happening.
Yeah.
And if this is part of his characteristics, then that's how it comes out. Yeah. But also in Holland, we had this magazine about non-duality, and when I first started to talk about this, I'm talking in Holland on the radio about this subject with a famous DJ, and they were like, a comedian and a DJ, no, our Advaita, it's been ruined. So we were banned from websites and magazines for years, because they were like, gross. And now they all want to cooperate because we become so popular. And suddenly it's like, hey, we can get money out of it. That's fine. But also that's just happening, it doesn't matter. But in the whole process of awakening there, like, we've been, let's say, addicted to this concept of being a separate I, and once you realize that it's not true, that there's no one in here, it's detoxing. And in this detoxing process, you get through, we talked about yesterday, the different phases of trying to convince everyone and try to make everyone believe this, or feeling superior that I know better, and also using it for your own benefit. Like, if I would come in the door and there's this huge ancient vase, and I'm like, yeah, that's just happening. Yeah. Then we use Advaita to not feel guilty or not take responsibility. But what would be normal is that when you break the vase, you're just like, oh, I'm sorry, and I'll make sure you get a new one. Because at the moment someone is using non-duality to find an excuse for himself, then I can guarantee you this is the separate I trying to get away with things by using this concept. And that happens a lot.
I guess a lot when you're insulting people, it's a better excuse just to say, oh, it just happened.
It just happened.
Yeah. To say, I'm sorry.
Yeah. Or when you do something and you don't show empathy to other people at all, you just do everything for your own benefit. You're like, yes, but this is how the body-mind mechanism felt in the moment.
Yeah.
Yeah. But at the moment people pick up non-duality and then talk about it, about their behavior, it's an excuse. They call this the Advaita shuffle.
Advaita what?
Advaita shuffle.
Shuffle?
The shuffle, like shuffling. Shuffle.
Shuffle?
S-H-U-F-F-L-E. Shuffle.
Shuffle, sorry.
Shuffle. No, my English is not perfect
shuffle.
At all.
Yeah.
Like shuffling.
Playing
yeah.
Cards.
Yeah.
Shuffle. Okay.
Mission. Mission. Shuffle player. CD player.
Yeah. And also, what happens is then when pain comes up, you're really hurt. Like, for instance, your partner has cheated on you, and she says, well, I slept with your best friend. Mm-hmm. Of course, this biologically is like, ow, fuck. But then what you do is like, well, it is as it is. Huh? It's, sure, this is just happening. I'm not hurt at all. No, this is just part of life expressing itself. Or you're in a shop and someone moves in front of you. Yeah, then yeah, he couldn't help himself. Well, being first. Just no, of course not. It's like, hey, get back, I was first in row. But as long as this smart eye comes, it's like we talked about this with the spirit, like egos in businesses are easy because a businessman has got an ego, and they're mostly, yes, this is me, I got an ego. But if I want to touch your ego, I just push you, you're like, yeah, ego. But spiritual ego are slippery like an eel. It's like, they're ungraspable. It's like, and especially because they think they are so enlightened, it's impossible. So I rather prefer just, like one of my friends, he's really famous, and he just says, yeah, this is me. My ego is huge, I'm a narcissist, woohoo! I'm like, yeah, that's honest. And he loves it. So, and it's so pure, like, yeah. He loves looking at himself, he loves to go to the fitness school and have the muscles, and then I'm like, yeah, cool, that's pure. That's much, I love that. It's people that know, I don't care how I look, and it's not true.
It's tricky. And what you say, when you're in everyday situations where everything actually is shuffled,
yeah,
it's very tricky.
Yeah. So a lot of people wake up halfway, find a nice place, and then it's okay. I can get away with things now. But life will challenge you anyway, so.
Yes, because life's going on.
Going on, and life is so smart. It will always give you the situations where you've been triggered. And of course, if you're in the shuffle, you can't help that. It's part of life expressing itself. So there's nothing good or bad about it. It's just, it's not being totally dissolving into life itself. There's still identification. This is me. This is me plus Advaita. And mostly people don't talk about these matters. It's mostly just about the rational Advaita part, and then. Part of our nature is what we call in evolution sexual selection. That means if we look at the how do you call it? The palm with the beautiful tail? What's the name?
Peacock.
The peacock. Peacock. Oh, okay. Peacock is an obvious example of sexual selection. it by showing his huge tail with the beauty, it's creating a lot of attention from the females, so it can reproduce itself. And they did research, and then they cut off a part of the tail, and then for 1 year the poor guy just walks around alone, doing nothing. So it's horrible. And the funny thing about sexual selection, sometimes it's getting so extreme, like the deer with the, how do you call this stuff here? The horns? The
horns. We know what they mean.
Yeah.
Because the female deer would love the males to have huge horns. That was sexual selection, because if you can carry something like that, you must be really strong. That also goes for the peacock. If your tail is so big and obvious and you can still survive, you have to be really strong, because it's not useful at all. But then with the deer, the sexual selection became so extreme that they couldn't hold their heads up anymore, and they died. And that also goes for the crabs with the scissors. At a certain point, they become so big that they can't move anymore. They also die. So sexual selection is a funny thing. But we are programmed for millions and millions of years to have this sexual selection thing in us. Therefore, we men try to brag a little about our career and what we have achieved and the money we have and how successful we are. And women, they wear makeup to look more fertile, to look more healthy, have big eyes, have a very smooth skin, red lipstick, so it's like more blood is going through the lips. Mm-hmm. This is part of our nature. So trying to sell the message that you don't care about how you look or if you're successful or not, is simply not true. It's a programming that we've had for millions of years. It's not that in one decade you're like, well, I don't care. And even the Buddhists who shave off their hair and don't shave their legs anymore, etc., and wear the special clothes, is also sexual selection, because they think we're not like them, we are special like this. So you can never get away, you can never get out of it.
Even if they don't have a benefit of it, because they will not have women, because they don't even meet with women. So this is what I didn't understand yesterday when you said that.
Yeah, still. Also, if you don't have the urge to get children, then the body will act exactly the same. And also the men or the women you pick to have relationships with, it's all based on reproducing. Even though there's no desire in someone to have children. So we men, if we meet a woman, the first thing we do, we scan if she is healthy and fertile. So if you got a smooth skin, is she beautiful, is there symmetry? And yesterday we saw we do that in 0.2 seconds. It's like, so we men are more likely to fall in love instantly. It's like, you're beautiful, that's it. For a woman, it's quite tough to find a good guy, because the way you look is not that important for a woman, but she needs to find a man who's reliable, can take care of the family, who is a little intelligent, have money, have a little status, who can be trusted, who has morality. But for a woman, there are so many variables that she has to check before she can get a man. So she doesn't fall in love so fast. And also what women do is really smart. They check what other women will think of a guy. Because if other women approve a guy, then the female brain, this is all going unconsciously, will think, oh, he's okay. Therefore, what happens if you're in a relationship, suddenly we men, you must experience this also, have a lot of attention from women. But once you're single, then no women at all. Because their brain will be like, he's single, something's wrong. They take away. So one of the tricks to get a lady is to go in a disco and make sure you talk with just female friends you have. And then other females will be like, oh, he's talking to a girl, she's approving him, he must be okay. It's just an evolutionary trick. Yeah.
Or buy a wedding ring, even if you're not married.
Yeah.
It's so
good work. Simple. Yeah.
It's so simple. But not easy.
No, not easy. So anyway, the reason I am sitting here is sexual selection. I can come up with a great story about I want to spread this message so the whole world will wake up and we'll become one day. And then play a John Lennon song.
Yes.
But let's just be honest, I'm sitting here because this is sexual selection. That's it. There's nothing wrong with that. But that's the only answer that's a little bit honest.
Perhaps that's a better title, Paul.
Yeah, but sexual selection.
Sexual selection.
So this goes for every teacher. I mean, they realize this is it. And then the next time they write books, just like me, and then create a website. And on their website, there's a very good picture of themselves. You never take the photo where you look like, it's always like,
this one.
This is me, yeah. No, but look at all the gurus and all the, me too. It's like, it's a picture where you look really good. It's just.
Do you have a folder like this?
No, me too, obvious. Oh, we made one yesterday, by the way. But even everyone's talking about this has got a website with his name, with a picture of himself, with some beautiful quotes about his teaching, his agenda. And it's fine, it's fine. But the body-mind mechanism will always try to sell a better version of itself. Even though there's no identification, because it's just in the biological programming. Well, this is not a popular message, I know. They know me, I'm doing it for the love of God.
But it's more relaxing not to try to overcome this, but to accept it is like that.
Yeah!
That's what he meant.
Beat it! Yeah. If there is makeup, if there is wearing a blouse like this, it is! The problem exists when the mind thinks, oh no, I'm wearing an expensive blouse, this is not spiritual, what will they think of me? They think I'm a fraud. You know, then the struggle begins and the suffering begins. But even Byron Katie and Gangaji, they have all done plastic surgery and everyone is like, oh, that's not spiritual. No! If that happens, it happens. It's the resistance to that which makes the struggle.
So self-transcendence is not self-neglection, but self-acceptance.
Yeah, but it's not that you try to accept, it's just there is acceptance anyway,
yeah.
No matter what the body-mind system does, because there's no one in here doing anything. It's just this piece of energy happening. And if that's a scene, that's it. You don't have to accept anything, because it just happened. But we think that there is some kind of spiritual behavior that you have to show in order to be enlightened, and that's where the struggle begins. Trying to not be mad, trying to not be sad anymore, trying to not be hurt anymore.
This could go so far as changing your sex, I mean gender.
Yeah.
I mean, this is just...
And also, I have girlfriends that would try to not have sex anymore because that was not spiritual. And then you're trying to suppress your sexuality. Only works temporary.
Only?
That only works temporary. Whatever you try to suppress, not that you're doing it,
yeah.
But when suppression happens, it's like holding balls underwater, and at a certain point it's like, comes out. Also, when politicians, they have to be very careful every day not to say this, not to say that, so the whole day they are suppressing what they actually want to do, and what happens is that a lot of politicians, they find the extremes besides their work, so a lot are totally addicts, like heroin, alcohol, and a lot of goes go to hookers and have sex parties, because the suppression, it wants to get out again. And that's all part of the nature of these things. And in the end, when they seen that this is it, it's the end of the judgment about yourself. You don't have to accept anything. I mean, do you have to accept that these lights are in this room right now? You're like, No, of course not. There are just lights. Yeah. But the moment we say, okay, I will accept it, that you've turned on that light, then there's resistance. Because whatever is already accepted isn't even noticed. So people are so funny because they think, no, I'll accept what you did yesterday. It's okay, I'll accept it. No, you're saying, you asshole, you shouldn't have done that. That's what you're actually saying. Or when people are, no, yeah, when we broke up with my ex-boyfriend, yeah, it was a tough time, but I'm over it now. No, you're not. You wouldn't even mention it if you were over it. My dad is so funny, he looks to the clouds like, oh, this great weather. Well, this doesn't influence my mood. It does. But that is also spiritual behavior. It's like, no, I will not be influenced by this. But what we're talking about, if you think shit, just think shit. That's it. Don't suppress this, like, wow. And that's such a relief. And that's, for me, the difference when I'm with energies who woke up from a dream, let's say, there can be just, wow. But as soon as there's identification, you have to, you notice that when you're talking with someone, you have to be careful. Oh, let's not mention this. Let's not talk about this. There, you talk with strategies, and it becomes so, in business as well, you know this. We have to talk in strategies sometimes, and it's like, also within, like, with Christmas, you have all the family comes together, and it's like, oh, you cannot mention the alcoholic problem of your uncle. Don't mention about the breakup of your sister. Let's not talk about this. Everyone is like, be tactical. Oh, we're having such a nice meal. And then they get drunk and they say it anyway, and then there's another explosion in the family. And yeah, we're funny people. But as soon as there's identification, then people are being hit easily. Because if someone criticizes you and you believe his thoughts, like, and there you go. But once the belief systems stop and it's not been taken personally anymore, then it doesn't matter anymore. Someone can find you an asshole, it's like, well, then it's okay. That's the thought happening. And also then the idea that you have to make sure that everyone thinks you're a nice guy. Ooh, that's a tough one. Because there will be people where you resonate with, and there will be people where it's not happening. But then of course it's not spiritual if you don't feel a resonance. So from thinking that you are this separate entity being in control, there's simply the, let's say, the awareness of what the puppet does. You see the puppet walking around, the puppet speaks, the puppet dances, the puppet cries, the puppet laughs. And that's just what it does.
Maybe you mentioned it yesterday. There was, was it in this case there, this change? Was it more like a flash event, or was it slowly that things changed and then that kind of awakening happened slowly, or was it like a...
I've heard different stories. For some, there was like, okay, they could feel something happening. With me, I didn't even notice. Actually, what happened, I was trying so hard to get it and understand it, and I was for 1.5 years reading the books, and I was like, shit, nothing changes. And I became so frustrated that I knew that everything was just happening, but still there was total identification, and there was still the daily struggle. And then I got so frustrated that I thought, I'm going to quit with this whole Advaita shit. So I threw away all my books and I was totally done with it. And then it happened. But I didn't even notice it. So what actually happened was the surrendering of something in here that thought it could get something. And by this hopeless feeling of I'm not gonna get it, there was actually the surrendering happening, like throwing away your books and I'm not gonna get it. And that was the beginning, let's say. But it's tricky to tell about it. Then people go home and say, okay, I'm gonna throw away my books. Yeah. And so waking up with every human being, it works in a different way. But for some it's like tick and you never know. And besides, it doesn't matter at all, because whether there is struggle or relaxation, it's just life expressing itself constantly. So if we think that struggle is worse than enlightenment, then we're stuck again. And then maybe this enlightenment thing is also a huge addiction for people. Because the only one who wants to become enlightened is the ego. So are there any questions, or are you all enlightened now?
Almost.
Almost.
I think 1 hour more and
we... Then it's... Yeah, I thought so. Just keep drinking a bit more wine, then we'll get there.
That works.
You'll feel awesome in an hour.
I was already enlightened before I came here, didn't you recognize?
Yeah. That's why you came a little later, right? You showed up a little late yesterday.
Yes.
But it was just because of that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, then you're...
Now, because enlightened people don't know the dimension of time anymore, so they just come whenever they come. It's really good. You totally got it.
You're a real guru. Thank you.
Only real enlightened people recognize real gurus.
So, I would like to pay a little bit more.
Yeah, I'm sure you
can.
Yeah.
No,
can I give you something?
No problem. Yours, anytime.
So it's amazing we already talked for 5 hours about something so simple that everything is as it is.
Strange enough.
Strange enough, yeah. And if we would be able to describe non-duality in words, that we could totally get it, we would be finished within 2 sentences. But you know, just pointers, just descriptions, and it's not it. It's like the Tao that's been written is not the real Tao. So the concept that you have to accept everything, you cannot accept something, because then you're already resisting. And also, when in the body mechanism resistance comes, it comes. If someone wants to steal your car, then most probably the body-mind mechanism will act to stop him from stealing. So resistance happens. Also, if people play games with you, then resistance might come up. But what drops away are these thoughts that there is something wrong with your actions or someone else's actions. But it's really tricky to get this into words, because every word I speak, it's tricky, actually.
But also this is ambivalent sometimes. Because if you hit me, for example, then there is this reaction, I want to hit you back, but something also in me perhaps does not want to hit, because I don't like to hit people on the whole.
Yeah.
So I have both in me. I want to hit back, but I can only do one of those two. I cannot hit and not hit.
No.
It's only one chance, hitting or not hitting me back. And if there's both impulses, that's what I mean, it's ambivalent. And perhaps there are even more impulses. I just know those two, but perhaps there are some more.
But the funny thing about the brain is that there are different modules competing with each other. So you can feel a lot of emotions come up. Like, I'm gonna forgive, I'm gonna hit, mm-hmm. and suddenly something comes out. But especially when it's like a hit, then it's instantly there's a reaction. You only come aware of your reaction afterwards. Because it's like... Doo-doo. Also, when you buy something, then your rewarding system in the brain says, yeah, I need this, this makes me happy. But the insula, it's the pain system in your brain, it says no, because when you spend money, this part is activated. What's so amazing is that these two modules are competing with each other. You're standing in front of the shoes, just for example. And it's like the rewarding says yes, and the pain says no. And then suddenly one of these modules, they win, and then you buy it or not. But it's not your choice, it's just what happens in this machine. And the pain in your for paying is the same pain as physical pain, or also when you have a relationship that ends, you feel also this pain. It's the same part of the brain that's been triggered. Even the thought about things that might be happening activates this part, and you feel the pain just by thinking about it. That's why in a casino they let you pay with different coins, because when you pay with different coins you're not aware that anymore that about the connection with the real money, so there's less pain, so you'll spend more. Or when you pay with credit card, you spend 15% more than when you have to pay cash, because this hurts. I mean, imagine you buy a house and you have to pay 240,000 euros, and you'll be sitting there like 50, 100. Man, you would die, like, ah! Mm. So you'd rather just do it on the computer, like, enter. So when you sell your art and someone is also competing in his brain while standing there, and if, for instance, they think you're a nice guy and they feel connected to you, then the rewarding system will be more activated than the pain system, and they'll buy it. And also, what we're talking about is you have these beautiful frames around your paintings. That's also increasing the rewarding system. So, and even the building where it's in, or if it's surrounded by nice pictures like we saw yesterday, there are so many tricks to influence the brain. Like this friend of mine who's the director of Audi, he's such a good salesman. People come in and he would be like, I'm gonna sell this car to them. I'm like, yeah, right. And he sells it. Because he's so trained in these marketing tricks, like tick, 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 tick. At a certain moment he became so good at it that he felt guilty afterwards. This couple would come in, and there was a special congress about cars. They would come in and he would go, okay, all his tricks. And suddenly these people came on stage. You bought a new car, what car did you buy? And this couple was like, what color is the car? They didn't know. And he was like, oh shit, I'm so sorry about this. Well, you bought this car. And they're like, ah, yeah. So you can manipulate people if you know the tricks, actually.
It was his awakening.
Now, at least it's awakening to realize maybe this doesn't give me a really
yes.
good feeling.
That's
yeah.
what I
mean. Yeah. And life becomes so different if you blame someone or action someone did, when you actually believe that there is a puppet in someone who did something, who had a choice, and it's a total different emotion you feel from realizing that it's just energy at play. Because then, even though you might not agree with someone did, or this doesn't give you a good feeling, there is the forgiveness of automatically, like, okay, this was just part of life playing the game. So it's totally innocent in that way. And then it's like, ah.
Next time your girlfriend betrays you, I will remember. I will remind you of that.
Oh yeah, she did. And I did with her. But it's like, it can be painful in the moment, but I've experienced this before when a girlfriend cheated, and it caused me pain for years, and I was not able to trust people anymore. And every time I had an argument with her, I would bring up the story again. You remember you cheated on me? So I would use it as a joke or to make her feel guilty, so she would please me more and do what I want. But that's where the whole strategy circus begins. But cheating happens.
When a person, for example, has a thought, I don't like this, the reason for it is anger, for example. And then the thought is expressed, and it repeats itself. And it repeats itself maybe the whole day.
Yeah.
I don't like this, I don't like this, I don't like this. Then the cause is always anger. So if you still have then in the thought systems a cause and effect? Or is it just also something spontaneously every time occurring new? The anger comes up new, and the effect of I don't like this is again the same sentence that comes out of this anger as a thought form.
Mm-hmm.
Is that true, or the cause and effect then do exist in repetition of thoughts in the mind, or sometimes
yeah,
experience these kind of...
I'm going to be radical now. There's only this moment. So if in this moment something occurs, then that's what's happening. And we can only go back in time in thoughts. So, and then we create the story, I was mad, so it repeats itself, and I was mad, and it repeats itself. But that's only in the story. But in the moment, then anger may arise. But we don't know what cause and effect is. Maybe everything starting with the Big Bang is cause and effect. But if so, then a billion actions and reactions are moving through each other simultaneously. So it's impossible for us to understand why we are here, why we look as we look, why the world is as it is, why we feel tension, why we have thoughts, we absolutely don't know. But it's only the ego that wants to know why, because it thinks if I know the why, I can control it and I can get rid of it. So then we want to grasp it and find the logical thing. And then we go to therapy and we start creating stories about the past, we bring it up and we try to explain that the feelings we now have are caused by my past. But that's all in the story. But once it's seen that all these thoughts and feelings, they're not yours, they simply come and go. And the whole idea of trying to hold the thought, trying to control it, try to push it away, that drops away. So it just comes and it goes. And there's no longer the need then to find any cause or effect. But that might be a quite empty feeling in the beginning, because there's nothing to grasp anymore. Non-duality is actually when you've got a whole line of how do you call it? Things you hold on to.
Mm-hmm. Handles,
like a concept, like I'm my career. This happened to me in the past. These are my friends. These are my Twitter followers. And every handle is like it breaks, and it's like oh shit. So in the process of awakening, you try to grab as much as you can, and the last one is mostly the handle non-duality. It's like and then suddenly it's, and then everything you try to hold on to is it's gone, and then for the ego this is scary shit. It's like it's like this free fall you're making. It cannot trust on anything, it cannot rely on anything. It can only rely in a way that you know that you are this oneness, you are this pure love in which everything appears. So at once it's like, it's a dropping together with the universe. It's like, you're not longer that contracted puppet who thinks it needs to control life. And it's like, I'm the ocean instead of just the wave. Who needs to control which way it goes? But in the awakening, this happened to me for a long time. I knew that everything was simply happening, and I knew rationally that this thing was simply doing as it does, but I didn't fully trust it. Mm-hmm. There was not the real trust that life will carry me, let's say. So. But I realized that for a long time in my life, I had like, as a metaphor, two hands on the wheel. It's like, okay, I need to control life, go left, go right. And suddenly it was like, hey, I'm not holding the wheel. And so one hand, but still for a long time, I had like one hand on the wheel, just in case. Until I was totally hopeless, like I'm not gonna get it. It's useless. And I threw away everything, and that was also in storyland, as I said, because I tried to figure out cause and effect new, but in the story, so it seems, it was like surrender. But even that story is like blah blah. But actually everything I've been saying for 6 hours now is blah blah. It's totally nonsense. It makes no sense at all, it's just I'm sorry you had to pay money for this crap. I'm so sorry. But then again, just to try to make you feel less bad. It's like the famous metaphor from Ramana Maharshi. You have this one thorn in your hand. This is the I concept, the idea that you are a separate entity. Then there is non-duality, which is also nothing more but a concept. But with this thorn, you take away that thorn, and then you say. Because I've seen a lot of people also with me, at a certain point, non-duality, it doesn't, you can't read anything anymore, you don't like listening anymore, it's like, phew. Sometimes my friend does a new interview for a website, and I look for 5 minutes, I'm like, oh, please. I don't want to hear it anymore. And still I'm listening to my own blah blah now for 6 hours. But maybe it's my ego who likes to listen to it. So. But the great thing is that this awareness that is here, that is aware of what's coming out, is the same awareness that's there watching. There's no difference between this hearing the words and this hearing the words. It's for us both a surprise what comes out, and we'll never know what's next. So you witness your own words in the same way you witness the words of someone else. You're just listening to your own speech in a way. But then the only thing is that when Paul speaks, that my brain thinks, oh no, that this is him speaking, and when I speak, my brain creates the illusion, these are my words.
But it's always Paul.
It's always Paul, yeah. That's it. There's only one Paul.
Only one Paul inside. Why did you choose him for this example? Because it's the double Paul.
Yeah. That's a good one. They should call everyone Paul. It's easier. Yeah. Who are you? Paul. I'm also Paul. We're one. Wow. What a discovery.
It's not Paul, it's Paul.
Yeah, it's Paul. That's it.
How did you find back to your trust in relationships after what you said before?
I couldn't care less. I couldn't care less. No, I don't know. I don't know anything anymore. I don't know what a relationship is. All I know is what's happening in the moment. Even that is a description. Mm-hmm. So I just see how life unfolds. So sometimes there's pleasure, sometimes there's pain. It's just whatever arises. So the relationships that we have created in, let's say, our normal understanding, like how society sees relationships, it's like we are together and we promise each other to be with each other forever. I mean, you just don't know. I don't even know what the next sentence will be that comes out of this mouth. So I don't know if my relationship will last a day, a year, 10 years. It's not in my hand. It's not in her hand. Whatever happens. And if I look back at all my previous relationships, they came and they come and go. They're like buses. There will always be a new bus. No, we just don't know.
So you are not living in the storyland of Lisa will be the princess of my lifetime and until the end of this lifetime, the next, and so on.
No, we don't know.
Nothing of that.
We met each other by surprise, and now we'll see what happens. By surprise, we might go there, and then that's what's happening. And then it's not her fault, it's not my fault, it's just life playing the game. And at the same time, these body-mind mechanisms are programmed in a certain way. So when, for instance, when we're in love, we're programmed to totally be focused at each other. That's the programming. And if someone sleeps with another guy or another girl, we're programmed to not like that. That's just the programming. And that will always remain. But not the story above that, that it's her fault, she shouldn't do that. Or it's my fault and I shouldn't do this. But relationships are interesting. They're simple, but not easy. It's always challenging. Yeah. And also when the ego looks for this perfect relationship where everything is in bliss. When you're in love, that's the way the brain is, the illusion the brain creates. When you're in love, well, I won't mention all the parts of the brain that get active, but you're in some trance, you're melting together and the whole world is bliss. But once the chemicals are gone, then they're like, what? Who did I choose? So it's funny. Yeah, and like everything in life, yin cannot be without yang, therefore we can experience by opposites. So in your work, in your relationships, in your friendships, it's always that. Someone comes on your path, it's nice, and then it's like breathing in and out. But you don't worry about breathing in and out. When you breathe in, it's not like, oh shit, I'm gonna breathe out. No, no, oh fuck, I breathe out. And then hey, I'm breathing in again. And you don't think about it. Like, but in life, when it does this, then it's like, yeah, so hold on to this. It's going this way. No! We're panicking by the movements of life. But life will always challenge you. It's like a ride in a roller coaster. Like the roller coaster will go as it goes, just as life goes as it goes. But if you're in the roller coaster and you think, oh, I want to go to the left, it's, oh, it goes to the right. It's, oh no, something went wrong. And then you go, whoa, loop, oh, why does this happen to me? I mean, and if you think that it should be different from the ride that it is, then you're constantly panicking at every curve, at every movement it makes. But life will, this is a roller coaster. You're being like, whoa, and then you die. But there's either being in the roller coaster and being like, okay, here we go, or there's like, no, because we think there's a steer in the roller coaster and that we control the thing, and that's the joke. So relax, nothing is under control, nothing.
That's a good quote. You should have this on your website. Life is a roller coaster, then you die.
Well, life is a roller coaster is from comedian Bill Hicks. He said this. He said, "Don't worry, don't be afraid ever, because this is just a ride." And I added this positive end, like, and then you die.
It's a good one.
But the great thing is, you cannot die. Of course, it's impossible to die. Because the energy you are can never leave. What you are is already. Of course, this form might change. And who dies? You were never here. There's no one inside here that can die. I mean, if you think that death is dying, then in your deepest sleep, you're dead. There's no self-awareness in your deepest sleep. If you would die in a deeper sleep, you would never know. It's no awareness. Nice, huh? To end the talk with dying. Let's talk about destruction and mass murder. So, it was a pleasure being here, by the way. I really enjoyed it. So although you couldn't do anything else than what you did, thanks Paul, and thank you for the hospitality and the free coffee and the great meals. And for offering the house. It's really nice. So, are you enlightened now?
Almost.
Almost.
Give me two more minutes.
Two more. I want my money back. Half of it. I'm a half enlightened.
You can deduct this 2 minutes.
Sure, I'll talk for 2 minutes.
No.
No, yeah, that's the wine. Yeah. So, thanks for being here.
Thank you.
How big was this audience?
No problem.
Who would need that?
No one here needs it.
The other Paul.
Yeah. I organize talks who are so huge that yes, all.
And the opposite is so awesome because it's so quiet in the talks and then afterwards.
Yeah. It's a real quiet audience.
Like there are only 5 people?
Yeah, 5 people who replied. The other 1,000 people, they were like...